You're listening to the Heart Lessons Podcast with me, Sarah Rieke. Real women, real stories, real faith. Hello, friends, and welcome to another episode of the Heart Lessons Podcast. I'm your host, Sarah, and I'm so thrilled that you're joining me here today. I hope you had a chance to check out the Intentionality series that released last month. Some really great conversations with some wonderful people about how to live certain areas of life with more intention. So if you haven't had a chance to listen to those, go ahead and check those out. Today, I am so excited to introduce my guest. Her name is Mo Isom, and today is her launch day for her newest book entitled Sex, Jesus, and the Conversations the Church Forgot. And so in our conversation today, we are going to talk all about the things that she shares in her book. It's just an incredible testimony that she has about what happened in her life when she lost focus of the why behind the purity that God calls his children to. And as she says, it's so important to know what God calls us to and why he calls us to it so that we don't give the enemy a foothold from the start. I just want to take a minute here before I introduce my conversation with Mo to just say that the subject matter in this particular episode I would label for mature audiences. You know, there are some words that we use and some things that we talk about that I would say are not for little ears, and certainly nothing inappropriate or lewd or crass in regards to Mo's testimony. But that being said, you know, if I were in the car with all of my kids driving somewhere, this might not be the conversation that I would just want them to overhear. But it is an incredibly important conversation. It is so powerful. I'm telling you, you are not going to want to miss the things that Mo says and how she talks about God and the purity that he calls his children to. It's truly amazing. And so without further ado, here is my conversation with Mo Isom. Well, thank you to everyone for tuning in to the Heart Lessons Podcast today. I'm glad to have you with me, and I'm so excited to have my guest today here with me, Mo Isom. Mo, how are you doing today?
I am doing great. It is just a treat to be on.
Yes, and it's worth mentioning that I remembered to push record this time, so hooray.
Luckily, it's like Groundhog Day.
Oh my gosh. That's my worst nightmare. Yeah, that's too funny. Well, anyway, thanks for being gracious with me. And so I'm going to congratulate you again on today's book launch day for you. Yay.
Yay. Thank you so much. This is exciting and just all the things, all the feelings. Launch day is crazy for an author, and busy and hectic and just really wonderful. So I'm excited for this book to be out there now for anyone and everyone to pick up. I hope it starts some really important conversations.
Yeah, I think it will. And I just wanted to just up front say thank you so much for your vulnerability and your bravery in writing this book, because you share some really, really personal stories. And I can imagine that it could feel just really intimidating to put yourself out there the way that you did. But just thank you for doing that, because I think it shows that you know that what God can do with your story and even the really painful and shameful parts of your story far outweigh any shame and any, you know, any shard of shame that you might still feel. So just thank you for that testimony in and of itself.
Absolutely. It is, it's really, you know, I think when we step into vulnerability and step into authenticity, just as people, it becomes a great honor to sort of partner with God in the kingdom work. Even when we're the ones airing out, you know, our sin struggles and our dirty laundry and all of these things. When my first book, Wreck My Life, released, I felt nervous and anxious and, you know, overwhelmed. And it was just so much of this really messy stuff that made up my testimony. But with this launch of Sex, Jesus, and the Conversations the Church Forgot, that nervousness is so replaced with just this incredible confidence in exactly what God will do. He is who he says he is. He is faithful. Scripture tells us that sin is defeated by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimonies. Mm-hmm. And so I feel like there probably should be like knots in my stomach that my sexual testimony is now just mm-hmm. out there for anyone and everyone to pick up and read. But truly, if we believe God is who he says he is, and if we believe the truth of the scripture that invites us to participate in this kingdom work that's hard but holy, mm-hmm. that's like bears it all but brings people to the foot of the cross, then I don't know, the nervousness in many ways has just been replaced by great anticipation. I'm excited to see where this book goes and how it impacts individuals and families and teenagers and adults alike. And I'm just giddy.
Yeah. Amen. That's, and like scripture says, when you take something that is in the darkness and bring it to the light, the darkness loses its power. And so that's, yes. that's what you've done with your story. So I just appreciate yeah. it so much.
Thank you. I totally agree. It's freeing for anybody that has a story. You have a story to be told. Mm-hmm. And it's amazing the power it fills us with when we speak it, when we write it, when we give life to it. We just steal any authority the enemy has over it. Mm-hmm. And it's like the most rock star feeling ever.
Yes.
If you can feel like a kingdom rock star, then sharing your testimony will bring you to that place.
Yes. Very good. Well, I want to start out, you start your book at the beginning talking about how for generations the church has focused on the question of what with regards to our sexuality, and the answer to the question what, like what should we do, is that we should save sex for marriage.
Right.
And so that is, you know, there's an entire generations of Christian young people who have gone through church thinking that, you know, virginity is the highest pinnacle of achievement, you know, for a Christian young person. And you just talk about the fact that that what question is probably the wrong question. And what we should be asking is why? Why are we supposed to be saving sex for marriage? And so will you just unpack that a little bit for us and tell us about this, the importance of the difference between the what question versus the why question?
Yeah, absolutely. It's, you know, I was raised in the what. I was raised in the make your virginity vow and, you know, this rule list of do's and don'ts and rights and wrongs. And, you know, I can't, this book certainly isn't an attack on the church. It's really a compelling, hey, we've got to dive deeper here, church. Mm-hmm. And I'm to the church, the body of believers, us as followers of Jesus Christ, we are, you know, preaching about the what's. We're standing on the pulpit, shaking our frustrated fists at the world of, you know, this failing morality, but we're actually missing the whys. We're missing addressing the heart condition here. We're missing what God has to say about sex, why he says it, what he calls us into, and why we would be compelled to abide, you know, why we would be compelled to obey, why we would trust that, you know, what God says about us and for us and the instruction that he gives us is good and is holy and is worth, you know, really laying down our lives to follow. And so, you know, this book really begins right at the start of scripture. Cause it's funny to me when the church thinks this is like too taboo or we're too pure to talk about it, because sex is the first conversation God has with man. I mean, mm-hmm. it's amazing. Right at the start of scripture, God addresses not only, our call to be fruitful, to multiply, to, you know, enjoy this gift from him, but also he marries it with these deep and beautiful words about our value as image bearing creations of God. And so, you know, if we're talking about the what, the do this, don't do that, but we miss the whys of you are an image bearing creation of God. He desires to use you. He desires for you to keep, you know, the vessel that you are as his creation pure so that he can powerfully move through you, so that you can guard your heart. You know, the whys of why it's beautiful to follow his design. When we miss that and we miss the reality that we are creatures made to worship, but quickly worship anything and everything we can, you know, get our hands on. That's what we want, what we think we need. We begin to see sort of the nature in us to choose for ourselves. God gives us this beautiful design. He instructs us in the whys, but we're fallen people and we're people who want to choose, you know, our own reasoning and our own rationalizations and, mm-hmm. you know, our own wants. And, I don't know. I think the book really beautifully breaks things down from the start. The why is where we must begin. The realization that we are people who choose to choose for ourselves, the realization that that leads us right into sin, and the beautiful revelation that God has the power to redeem every bit of it, but that we would be wiser to follow his instruction from the start, to know what he says, to know what he calls of us, and why he calls it of us, so that we don't even give the enemy a foothold from the start, you know, in the first place.
Yeah, you wrote this, I underlined it and dog-eared the page. I just thought it was so powerful. You wrote, it's about so much more than doing what's right and avoiding what's wrong. It's a reflection of preserving our bodies and our hearts for a God who gave his life for us first.
Yes. Yeah. I think a piece of the, you know, purity conversation that we miss, like side note, I feel like the term purity, we've almost abused and lost the beauty and value in. Hmm. Because there are these quick, you know, weekend conferences for young people, mm-hmm, and we put on the purity ring, and, you know, we sort of talk about this physical purity, but the purity God actually calls of us is a heart purity. Mm-hmm. It is one of heart. It is one of actions, words, thoughts, the way that we live our lives. He calls us to beautiful purity and surrender as a reflection of the purity of God who took the cross to redeem us, to make us new, the purity of the life Christ lived, the purity that collides with our very broken sin and calls us redeemed. There's incredible purity at the cross, and there's incredible purity in a God who can't and won't exist amongst sin. You know, mm-hmm. I mean, he's too holy. He's mm-hmm. too mighty. He's too pure, and we're not. And yet he still sent a pure and holy sacrifice to make a way for us, even amidst our rebellion, even amidst our sin. His purity still conquered it all. And what he asks of us is that our response to that great sacrifice would be a life lived purely, you know, in a life lived seeking his instruction, seeking his guidance, living empowered by the Holy Spirit, living like that sacrifice meant something to compel our lives to look differently.
So talk to me about what it looked like for you in your life when you were just compelled by the what instead of the why, and what that led you to experience.
Oh, girl, it looked like a hot mess of a yeah. testimony.
Yeah.
You know, I feel like when we go by the what instead of the why, when we sort of make these vain virginity vows and, you know, see this as a black and white matter, we get lost in the gray area in between. Mm-hmm. Because I was someone who wanted to push every boundary. I wanted mm-hmm. to have my cake and eat it too. I wanted to, you know, be able to wave this banner of virginity that looked good in the church body, but also kind of serve myself behind the scenes. And so for me, what it looked like was proclaiming, you know, this virginity vow, but not knowing my worth, my value, the purity I was called to. And so just pushing the envelope in every possible way. I mean, rounding every base I could without, you know, getting to the home run. I just really giving pieces and pieces and pieces of myself away mentally, emotionally, physically, to try to serve the sin in me. And really keep sort of this exterior title of virginity. But I was just as muddy and marred as someone who had, you know, gone all the way time and time again. I there's no difference between mm-hmm. the two, because it's not a marker of have you done this one final act and that would make you impure. It's a marker of what's your heart condition. And mine was just one that sought to serve myself and got lost in that, got broken in that. I mean, just really racked up shame, guilt, and a list a mile long of people I had given myself away to, yet still trying to rationalize in my heart that I was, you know, a good enough person. It was just, it was missed. It was a rule list, and it was religion versus a relationship with the Creator who had so much more for me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that's, it just makes me think of the Pharisees in Jesus' time who were so, you know, committed to the rules that they were missing the point of grace. And they were missing the point that Jesus was the Messiah because they were looking for something different. And Jesus was just like coming in and breaking all the rules essentially. And just saying, it's not about what you're doing so much as it is about how your heart is. And that they just could not understand that. And, you know, we aren't so different.
Yeah, we are not so different at all. And I think that's so beautiful that we can glean those parallels from scripture. Not only does scripture directly talk about sex time and time and time again, but it also, we can glean the beautiful parallels from the very things that maybe in scripture aren't directly talking about sex, but they're mm-hmm. directly talking to our hearts.
Right.
And we are the Pharisees. We mm-hmm. are the ones who want it spelled out and then want to cling to that and then want to, you know, rely on ourselves to redeem that when we just can't keep the rules, you know, when we yeah. just can't do it. And we're caught up in this cycle and failing to sit at the foot of the cross that really says, I don't care about your virginity vow. Virginity should be a byproduct mm-hmm. of a pure heart. I care about your heart. I care about what comes from the root of you. And if that is rooted in me, or if that is rooted in pride, rule following, you know, doing this and doing that, because that's just always leaves us bound up. It's like the enemy's greatest victory when right. we leave as Pharisees, you know, mm-hmm. because we're just the same. Maybe a different year on the calendar, but we're the same humans living in the same conditions, heart-wise, as they were 2,000 years ago.
Yes, so true. Okay, well, I wanted to, you have an entire chapter focused on pornography and the issue that it is today and your struggle in that area. And so I wanted to see if you could just explain how pervasive it is. I mean, you share some statistics and some facts in your book that were just staggering to me. And, you know, there's this top pornography site that had, you said, if you added up all the hours that had been spent there last year, it would equal 17,000 lifetimes, I think is what you said, which is just staggering. So can you just talk to me about how pervasive this is and how harmful it is? And then what we can do to just have a correct view of it and protect our hearts and minds and our eyes from this.
Yeah. So to shock every listeners real quick, what you were talking about on one pornographic website last year in 2 years ago now, in 2016 on one website, people consumed 4.6 billion hours of pornography at just one website. And there are hundreds of thousands for porn, right. but at one, we consumed 4.6 billion hours of pornography, which is 524,000 years of porn or 17,000 complete lifetimes. We as a people consumed that from one site in 1 year.
It's crazy.
And what's even more startling to me is that out of, you know, the 4.6 billion hours of porn consumed in that year, 88% of those scenes within those videos were depicting sex in a physically aggressive or violent manner. Mm. So if you do the math there, human beings around the world were allowing 4,048,000,000 hours of violent, aggressive, and humiliating sex acts to stream into their eyes and their hearts in 1 year. Mm. And it just, when I was doing the research around this book, it gutted me. It was gut-wrenching. Those numbers aren't even comparable to my mind. They're astronomical. And it's an indication that we as a people are dealing with an astronomical issue here that all begins in the condition of our hearts. And we as a people are just like sheep running off a cliff. We're just blind. We're just blind to our own depravity in so many ways. And these are conversations we have to start. And honestly, for me, I felt like this book, I think I even wrote it in all caps in the pages. I want to stand on a mountaintop as a woman and say, these aren't just issues men are dealing with.
Yeah.
You know, the church is kind of starting these pornographic conversations, but primarily they're directing them to males. Well, 4.6 billion hours consumed is a lot of female consumption as well. And it's something that feels so shameful and so embarrassing and so, you know, taboo that we're not talking about it as women, yet we're just imprisoned by it as women too. And not only for me was I, you know, because again, it's not a sex issue even of male female, it's a heart issue. Mm-hmm. And for me, I was exposed to pornography at a very early age, and about 9 years old. I mean, if that's a punch to the gut of anybody listening, and the children age is 9 years old. And that was even in the era where we didn't have it at our fingertips from mm-hmm. mobile devices. That was like the squinting on the fuzzy channels, like, you know, on cable TV, trying to figure out what things were. But I was exposed at 9 years old, and it grew not only a shame in me, but a curiosity in me. And I feel like Lisa Bevere talks about this. She talks about the fact that porn almost calls to us. It is something that, you know, intrigues us and confuses us and is, you know, shameful, yet we seek it out. And for me, it just became really a decade long struggle from 8 to 18 that I very much kept in the darkness, and something so many women are. Yeah. And the truth of the matter is that not only are women often struggling with, you know, really addictions to consuming it, but we're also struggling with then feeling like we have to emulate it, feeling like that is the mark of beauty, of power, of sexuality, the things that we're seeing on these screens. And really, I think it is completely blinding us to the realities of sex. It's robbing us of the sanctity of sex. It is desensitizing us to the humanity of the act. And I think we are a people now in this culture that are serving our instant wants and needs by opening up a computer or phone screen. And we are able to completely dehumanize, desensitize ourselves to what we are seeing because we are serving the sin in us. Mm-hmm. And it's, I could go on and on. That chapter is actually kind of long because it's just something I'm really passionate about. But, you know, we have got to become people that steal back the humanity that's been stolen from us, by, you know, the insatiable lust of the lost serving our carnal desires that are outside of God's design. We've lost self-control in so many ways. And really, we're looking at these people on these screens as body parts rather than sons and daughters of God, you know, creations of God, image-bearing creations of God. We've somehow have detached humanity from what we're seeing and what we're indulging in because it serves us. And I just think we're at a really, really sad time. Mm-hmm. But I also think at a time where Jesus has immeasurable power to redeem, where it's such a, you know, pervasive time of sexuality just saturating our culture, that opens the door for an incredible revival, an incredible opportunity for God to breathe humanity back into our hearts, to recapture our eyes, our souls, for his glory. And that's the exact thing he did for me at 18 years old. I prayed that he would, you know, I came to know Christ and I prayed he would give me eyes to see the world as he did and break my heart for what broke his. And the next time I opened a computer screen, because I had an urge to view pornography, it was nauseating. If we are bold enough to pray that prayer, that God would give us eyes to see the world as he did, we cannot look at pornography the same way. If we ask him to break our hearts for what breaks his, we cannot open our computers and our phone screens without the weight and the power of the Holy Spirit pressing on us in a very different way. And that was eventually how I was freed from that bondage. But it was a decade-long struggle for me as a woman. And I think there are a lot of women struggling with the same things.
Yeah, that prayer that you prayed, I dog-eared that page and I underlined it. And because I want to pray that for not only myself, but for my children. And I have two sons. I have a 7-year-old and a 1-year-old and a 3-year-old daughter. And I just, I don't know. I just want to pray that over their lives, especially as you said, like, it's so easy to access this inappropriate content. I mean, it's in our hands. It's literally in our hands. Yeah. And so I just want to pray that over them as well. And I just thought that part of your story was incredibly powerful. Just such a testimony of the transforming, like literally the transforming power of the Holy Spirit. So, just praise God for that moment in your life.
Thank you. I appreciate that. That was vulnerable stuff to share.
I can't
Somebody's got to say it. Somebody's got to say it, you know, and somebody's got to say it with the power packed behind it that Jesus can give us new sight, you know, that this doesn't have to be our bondage that we just slip in for the rest of our lives.
So what would you say to a woman who is deep in this struggle, but wants to get out? She doesn't know how, like, how can she take the first steps to get help? How can someone who walks alongside her, you know, help her get the help that she needs? Like, what do we do here?
Yeah, that's such a good question, because the practical is really important. The first and the most powerful is to pray those exact things we were just talking about. Because it's a heart condition issue. So it has to begin with shifting our hearts onto what is good, what is holy, even when it's hard, even when it seems impossible, even when those urges are just, you know, own us in so many ways, to keep a heart condition of God, give me eyes to see the world as you do. Break my heart for what breaks yours. Don't leave me the same. Holy Spirit, transform my heart. It begins there. I think another thing that's exceptionally important is to knock the knees out from the enemy and give voice to your struggle. Mm-hmm. Find someone you can confide in about this. Find an accountability partner who can help you with this and who you can be open and honest with and not feel ashamed, not feel afraid, but someone you trust and you can open up to. There are also incredible resources just online. There's sites and programs like Covenant Eyes that you can literally install on your computer, and it is an accountability program through your computer, through your phone. There are so many different approaches to guarding your eyes, guarding your heart, both practical and real world, as well as spiritual and Holy Spirit led. And so those are my three biggest pieces of advice. Get on your knees and start praying around it. Find accountability that's intimate accountability for you, someone you can regularly talk to and trust, and then literally guard your computer, you know, guard technology. It helps guard your heart. And what's crazy is that nowadays on like Twitter, porn will even infiltrate just trending hashtags, and open a totally, you know, innocent hashtag without somehow being bombarded by stuff. But there are even security settings on your Twitter, on your Instagram. There are like things that you can block sensitive material. And so just do it. Just do it. Yeah. Don't feel weird about it. Don't feel lame about it. Help yourself practically, you know, by doing all of those things to sort of contribute to the process.
How do you find an accountability partner? Because I feel like it would be so hard, such a hard thing to admit like the first time to someone else. So what kind of advice or just, you know, gentle push would you give somebody to say, push through the awkwardness, you know, this is, your life depends on it. Like, what would that push be?
You know, there is scripture that talks about those who know Jesus are free. They are free indeed. Mm-hmm. And when we let that awkwardness rule our lives, you are not living in the freedom that God intends for you. Mm-hmm. It is painful oftentimes to break through chains, but you're empowered by the strength of the Holy Spirit to obliterate the bondage that binds you up. And dying to self is not always comfortable. It's not always easy, but there is freedom on the other side of voicing your sin, of bringing it to the surface, of giving it life and then hacking the life out from under it. Mm-hmm. The enemy is defeated when we get ahead of the process, when we speak something, when we claim the name of Jesus Christ over it, and when we find that community, find that accountability. We were never creatures made to live life alone. Mm-hmm. Adam was miserable in the garden. God made him a helper. You know, as soon as he could, we're people made for community, for relationship, for partnership. And scripture calls us to boast in our weaknesses so that we can point to the glory of the cross, to give voice to our struggles so that we can point to the very thing that has the power to unensnare us from those struggles. We must become people who believe that, people who step into that, and people who just get uncomfortable for the sake of saving our own lives. It's like eternity in so many ways is at stake here, but we're nervous for a 5-minute conversation, you know?
Like,
weigh the costs here, you know, 10 minutes of awkwardness to broach a subject with someone, but a life of freedom from it, or, you know, eternal weight that's pressed on us when we can't surrender it. it's just not worth it. It's just, I guess it's hard. It's been so many years now. It's been almost a decade that I've been freed from that bondage. So sometimes it's hard to look back and remember how terrifying it was, because the freedom of moving past that nervousness is so sweet. It's like, man, I literally get on Instagram stories now and talk about, as a female, struggles with porn. And it's amazing the number of women who will message, oh my gosh, I didn't know we could talk about that. I didn't know, you know, thank you for saying that. People want to see someone else be courageous before them. And if you don't have people around you speaking those things and being courageous first, look at the courage of the cross that said you can be that first one. That's really courageous and really bold.
So talk to me about how you did move from a place of bondage to a place of freedom. What did that journey look like for you?
Well, it was so all-inclusive in my life. It went so far beyond just my sexual testimony. In Wreck My Life, my first book, people can really dive into the depths of my faith testimony. And really when God wrecked my life and revealed himself to me, it shifted the trajectory of everything. And sexual sin and sexual bondage, I find, is one of the first things that God kind of brings up to the surface for us, because it is so remarkably powerful. You know, even in comparison to other sin struggles, it is a sin against our own body. It's a sin against the very temple that we, you know, have, that's housing the Holy Spirit. And it's not that any sin is, you know, weighed any differently, but I just find that sexual sin is one of the first and most prevalent that God kind of brings to our hearts to wrestle with, because it is one that is so powerfully binding. And so when he, you know, brought that to my heart for me, not only struggles with pornography, but struggles with promiscuity, you know, struggles with masturbation, struggles with, you know, sexual sin that was, I was in so many ways enslaved to, but would never admit it at the time. He brought that up for me to reckon with first. And what he called me into was an intimacy fast, which is my own little copyrighted dubbed, like, everyone's always like, what is that?
Yeah.
Just called me into a season of being still, knowing that he was God and walking with him intimately. Scripture says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, all your strength. And for me, he brought that scripture to my eyes, and that all suddenly like became capitalized and non-negotiable and overwhelming. Give me all of yourself. And so he called me into just an intimacy fast from the world and a step into deeper intimacy with him. And so for a year, I treated anybody else like I would treat them if I were in a very serious committed relationship. I didn't date, I didn't talk, I didn't flirt, I didn't do anything physically. And I just kind of put on blinders and set my eyes on the cross and dug into the word and filled my heart with his truth and allowed him to do this hard reconstruction work in my heart. And it was challenging for the first 3 months. And when you pass that 3 month hump, it becomes amazing that you're 3 months in and that it's becoming easier and that you're realizing so much about yourself, that God's doing this great work. And then you pass that 6 month hump and it's just like empowering. You are growing so much. You're finally taking the time to clear away distractions, to learn about yourself, your worth, your value. And then you pass 9 months and it's like, you just hit the ground running. So my intimacy fast intended to be a year, and it went on 2 years because it was sweet. It was so sweet to be so intimate with God, to learn that all of my affirmation, all of my worth, all of my freedom comes from him alone. And it was amazing because the next man that I met after that, and I'm not saying, ladies, this is a recipe, do an intimacy fast and God will send you your husband.
right.
But it so happened that the next man that, you know, I paid any mind to, that God brought into my life, is now my husband. And it was amazing because I could approach that relationship so differently, but it was also amazing because I wasn't putting God-sized expectations on a man to fill holes in my heart. My heart had been filled, redeemed, found its worth, known its value, been empowered by the Holy Spirit, been healed first. And so then I could begin to step into, you know, the fire that is navigating relationships and sexuality, you know, again, but I could step into that with a different perspective and with a spirit-led conviction and heart, and it just changed the game. Mm. So that healing came from me by erasing, running from, turning off the distractions around me, and just setting my sights on the cross for a while.
Yeah. So I definitely want to talk more about your husband and your romance story and the ways that God redeemed your sexual testimony in your marriage, because, you know, as you said in your book, some healing still needed to take place. But I just want to back up a little bit. You said the first 3 months of your intimacy fast were the hardest. So did you have what sort of systems did you have in place for when you were incredibly tempted? Like, how did you distract yourself, or, you know, what were your incredibly practical steps that you would take to kind of run from these temptations that you were in such a habit in before?
Yeah, this is going to make not a single listener happy, because this is hard to do. It's hard work to do, but it's our heart we're fighting for. For me, I was in college at the time, and I tried when I you know, got back to school after my car accident, after Christ revealing himself to me. You'll have to read the first book to get the whole story, but it was really a radical revelation in my life. And I got back to school, and I think all of us want to kind of think, man, I know the truth. I know his grace. I'm so fired up. I can now step into these environments I've been in, and I can be a light. Kind of want to right away rationalize, my life doesn't have to change too much. I will now just, you know, be transformed, but kind of live the same way in the same places. And I tried that and failed so miserably. I stepped right back into the rhythm of my previous sin, and sin will win out every single time if we are not careful. Mm-hmm. And so what really had to happen very practically for me was that I had to step into a season of isolation with Jesus. And that means I had to say no to invitations out to events, out to parties, out to places that I knew could be a trigger for me. I had to say no to friendships that I should probably more so call acquaintanceships, because as soon as you tell them no the first time, you don't hear from them anymore. If you can't serve, you know, the sin in them as well, they suddenly stop calling. But I had to delete numbers out of my phone that were going to be a temptation for me to text when I was lonely late at night. You know, I had to say no to environments that I had known before. I had to say no to people. And I had to put myself first in allowing God to heal me without getting anxious and reopening scabs and wounds because I wanted something, or I wanted to be a place, or I didn't want to miss something, or I had FOMO, like fear of missing out on something.
Yeah.
I just had to start saying no to a lot. And that is something I feel like that's where we get most uncomfortable, you know, and we're like, no, I want to do this like faith walk thing, but I don't want my life I don't want to lose friends. I don't want to get that uncomfortable. I don't want to lose the relationship with my boyfriend or my girlfriend. Like, I don't want to. And that is where the enemy just keeps a foothold. Mm-hmm. We have to die to ourselves and pick up our cross and carry it. We have to say no and have discernment. We have to care more about our walk and our purity than we do about pleasing the people around us. And so for me, it looked like, honestly, a lot of time in my apartment. And the reason I say those first 3 months were hard was because it was lonely.
Yeah.
It was really lonely. But then it wasn't, because then I truly began to commune with God. And truly became fully dependent on his presence and delighted in his presence. And that loneliness void was filled once I moved through the growing pains of always needing to have someone around me or someone texting me on my phone. You know, it was filled so quickly. And that's why the next 3 months became so wonderful, because then I was communing with God, but then he began to send friendships along that were also in pursuit of him. You know, he began to align people in my life and open doors for community that were seeking the same things I was seeking. And that looked like, you know, ministry on campus. That looked like FCA. That looked like, you know, great friends who were also walking with Christ. And that was something that had been lacking in my life before, and something beautiful that he opened the door to when I finally set my sights on him long enough for him to, you know, guide friendships and relationships. And it wasn't as self-serving. It was more of an understanding of the body of Christ, able to help one another and hold one another accountable.
Mm. I appreciate you just being so real and just saying that, just talking about how difficult it really is, because, you know, we could sort of even idolize the transformation that comes after such a turn from sin, but there's a lot of hard work that's involved, and you know, just told us as much. So just thank you for sharing that. And I'm sure somebody listening is going to find great encouragement, and just thank you very, very much for those words, Mo.
Of course.
Will you talk to me about your husband and about your marriage, and just specifically about how, you know, even once you got married, you may have thought that all of your sexual temptations would have gone away, but really, like you said in your book, it's the time when the devil attacks you even more. So talk to me about just what you had to overcome even still after you were married, and just the sweetness of how Jesus redeemed that between the two of you.
Yeah, it was, well, I'll rewind to when we were dating, because like I said, he was, you know, a man that God brought to me following that intimacy fast. And I think I stepped into my relationship with him almost kind of arrogant after this intimacy fast, because I thought God's done so much work in my heart, transformed me in such a beautiful way. You know, surely this will be easier this time around to navigate sexual temptation. And I kind of just leapt in. And we missed having really important conversations about what are your triggers? What are your boundaries? What are, you know, we both knew that we wanted to save ourselves sexually until marriage. We both knew that, you know, he obviously was a follower of Christ as well. That was my first and biggest need on the checklist. Mm-hmm. But even still, we were both had our eyes set on purity. And when temptation came, and we hadn't had important conversations, and we had our guards down because we connected in so many other wonderful ways, and we were both Christ followers and all of these things, the temptation came, and still in many ways and many times it won out. Mm-hmm. And I felt like, you know, it's scripture's kind of rough about it, but scripture's like, better you have never believed in the first place than to believe and run right back into sin. It's like a dog returning to its vomit. And I'm like, oh, yeah, when I read that, it was so true.
It's bad imagery.
It is. It's rough imagery, but it was so true, because now I was filled with the Holy Spirit. And so now when the sexual sin temptation came and my flesh won out, there was so much more of a weight of conviction. There was so much more of a knowledge of sin and a knowledge that I was, you know, serving myself. And it was heart shredding, to be honest. Before you know Christ, the sins hurt, but we don't know truth yet. And so they don't weigh us the same. Once you're filled with the Holy Spirit and that sin enters in, it becomes debilitating. And so it really threatened our relationship in so many ways. It was a struggle. We were consistently wrestling, but knowing truth and, you know, then running from and then wrestling with again. And it, kind of became this roller coaster ride. And so we came to a place where we were like, this can't go on. And I began to dig into scripture about what it looks like, what God calls of us. And I found two options, just two, very, very clear two options. If we are in a relationship that has sexual sin, we have two options: to flee or to marry. Because scripture talks about run from sexual sin, run from it, break off the relationship, delete the number, get away from it, guard yourself more than you serve yourself here in sin, and either flee or marry. Paul talks about better for two to come together and wed than to burn in lust. And so I was seeing these two options and I couldn't really find any other choice, either leave the relationship or make the relationship holy in God's sight. And that's it. Mm-hmm. There's no living in this middle ground anymore of, you know, roller coaster ride. That's never where we were intended to live. And so we both committed to pray about it separately. And I went away on this missions trip for like 3 months, and it was this really beautiful time in our relationship where we were finally away from the physical temptation. We literally put states in between us.
Right, right.
And we committed it to prayer. And it was there that God just really encountered my heart and audibly. There's been few times in my life that God has just audibly spoken to me, and it was so audibly clear. He said, Jeremiah is the man that I have for you to marry. And that, I am not saying all this, flee or marry, like marriage is easy. It's a huge covenant weighted decision.
Yeah.
But it's also one that we have to look at. If we are in sexual sin, run from it, or don't let it be sin, you know, wed. And so God made it very clear to my heart. And then I just prayed he would to Jeremiah. I didn't know what the time.
Because it's not going to work if only one of you feels that way and not the other.
Right. Well, I'm going to go pick out a ring. I'd flee, please. You know, it had to be something that God spoke to Jeremiah's heart too. Yeah. So, it was beautiful because he did very quickly the same thing separately. And we came together and we knew that this was the direction that we needed to go. Not simply because we were head over heels in love, not simply because we were so happy, not simply because the chemistry was there. Sure, there were very fundamental things that were there and in place, but we also took a leap of faith into marriage because it was what Scripture called of us, and that was it, you know? And, mm-hmm. and so I stood at that altar across from my husband, in love with, grateful for, passionate about the man who was staring back at me, but more in love with and passionate about the God who guided me, and who called that of me. And, you know, stepped into marriage kind of thinking, well, there you go, God, we took the big step. So now the sexual testimony has a beautiful bow on the end of it. And I'm not in sexual sin anymore. And so, you know, let's go. And then very much realized that actually marriage is where the enemy will attack us the most. My sister-in-law said the greatest quote one time. She said, prior to marriage, the enemy will do everything he can to drive you together. Following marriage, he will do everything he can to drive you apart. Mm-hmm. And we came into marriage carrying sexual baggage that we hadn't fully yet processed and worked through. There was sexual baggage that reared its head that I wouldn't have even thought would have, you know, wouldn't have even known to pray through, because I didn't think it still, you know, owned me in many ways. Right. But there's a great chapter in the book called The Honeymoon Hardship. And it just talked about these challenges we then stepped into sexually in marriage that do exist and are very real for so many people, and how we had to surrender those very things too. And honestly, how we had to invite Jesus into the bedroom, as weird and taboo and, you know, silly as that sounds. Sex was God's invention. It is a gift. It is an act of worship. It is a weapon against the enemy. It is all things empowering and holy and covenantal and binding and beautiful in marriage. And it is important that we also begin to talk about sex within marriage as well, because it's just as much of a conversation I feel like we miss being talked to about. Mm-hmm. And it's one that's powerful and can lead to, honestly, beautifully united marriages, or can lead to the crumbling of marriages if it's not stewarded with understanding and with understanding of the power that it contains.
So talk to me about what you mean about inviting Jesus into the bedroom. Because like you said, it's a little bit strange. It sounds crazy at first. So, I mean, what does that look like? Yeah, talk to us a little bit about what that looks like.
Well, like I said, sex was God's invention. It was his creation, and it was created as a beautiful act of worship. That a man and a wife would come together as one flesh. And it is an exaltation to the King when we do. It is unifying when we do. And it's also something that it's a gift from God. It's a gift God delights in. It's not like God suddenly exits the equation when we close the bedroom doors and this is something hidden from him.
Right.
No, it's a beautiful coming together that God is well pleased with. And, you know, when I understood that, because our honeymoon hardships were the fact that, you know, we carried in these kind of false expectations, like that sex was going to be this amazing, mind-blowing, like, right, you know, fleeting thing the very first time.
Yeah.
So not the case. That suddenly that it was, you know, within the right guidelines, that it was just going to be easy and effortless and everything the movies and TV make it look like. So passionate, so incredible, which again is not always the case. It was, we brought in these false expectations that sex is just to serve us, that it's just sort of this pleasure tool to serve us. And we missed the truth and the weight that it is so much more. It is a laying down of your life for another person. It's actually an act of service. It's not just to serve us. And that was good and tweetable. But it really is in so many ways this amazing weapon against the enemy. Honestly, I write this in the book and it felt funny to type out, but so many people have sent back like, oh, this is so good. It's the ultimate middle finger to an enemy.
Oh, yeah.
Who wants to drive us apart. I read about the story of this man and this woman who lost their child. Their very young child died very unexpectedly. And they talked about how the first thing they did was they came together and they had sex. And I thought, well, that is awkward. I mean, of all the things, you know, in the face of tragedy. But they went on to talk about, because we needed to remind one another, we needed to remind the enemy, and we needed to remind God that we were unified in this. Mm-hmm. Husband, wife, with God as the Lord of our lives, we were going to come together and say, this will not divide us. We are unified. And when we start to see sex as a weapon against the enemy, as, you know, whether it's romantic, whether it's, you know, a quickie because you have a toddler screaming in another room, whether it is, you know, something you have to plan and put on the calendar, whether it's spontaneous, whatever it looks like within the boundaries of our marriage, at least for me and Jeremiah, it's always something that brings us together. It's always something that kind of helps us reset and just breathe. And it's always something that grows a beautiful compassion in my heart for him, you know, and it goes both ways. It's the most vulnerable thing. And it's so beautiful to come together with someone and know that it's something we can enjoy. And it's also something that, you know, just totally girds up our spirit and strengthens us. And so when we started to understand sex from that angle, when on my honeymoon, as I was crying for the fifth night in a row into my pillow, because I just had all the wrong ideas about sex, my body just wasn't in sync, my heart just wasn't in the right place, my husband pulled me up into his lap on the bed and he just started to pray. And he prayed with such desperate cries to God, knowing that God's gifts were good and holy, that within marriage, we shouldn't have this shame and bondage around it. He just started to pray on behalf of me, on behalf of him, on behalf of us as a unit, that God would just enter in, would be a part of this, because God was always intended to be a part of it. And that he would break these chains and this bondage that was binding us. It was just that simple cruise ship prayer that began to shift everything in our sex life very early on and began to put it in the right, you know, frame of sight and frame of mind for us and changed things. And we now, this will be like way TMI, but we often come together with worship music playing. Mm-hmm. And that seems so weird, but we conceived both our children to Hillsong albums. It's like, it's just, you know, it's just something that if we are in the right heart condition, it's not weird or awkward to know that God is in the midst of it. Mm-hmm. And it actually is a delight to know that it was a gift given to us and that it unifies us in all ways. And just cool. People are like unclicking the podcast, like, this girl is crazy. But I challenge you. I challenge you to play some worship music next time you're together with your husband or your wife and, you know, see what God has in store for the power of his gift, his act of worship given to us and what it does for our hearts.
Oh, I am so glad that that is part of your story. It's just such a sweet, I know it's not the end, but it's just a really sweet part of your story, your husband, and now you have two beautiful babies. And so I just love that we can add this part into what was a pretty painful journey to get to this point. So I have a question for you that it might come across as cynical, and that is not my intention at all. But
I know.
If someone were to have come to you when you were in, you know, the height of your promiscuity and all of this, and they came to you with this message, would you have listened? Like, would you have scoffed at them? Like, what do we do with this incredibly important and precious message to people who don't actually care to hear it?
Oh, that is such a great question. So good. I want to first go off of your final words there of people who don't care to hear it.
Okay.
Because I think on the surface, we look at the culture and where it is right now, and we look at young people and all they are indulging in and celebrating and are entertained by and all of these things. And it's our assumption that they don't care to hear these truths. And people, honestly, that have been scorned from these truths presented to them in the wrong way, like we talked about at the very beginning of this podcast, of this do's and don'ts, rights and wrongs.
Right.
It's almost intimidating to think it's easier to just kind of think these people don't want it. They aren't going to listen. You know, it's countercultural, and we're eating up everything that's cultural right now. But for me, I always have to come back to remembering that, like we talked about, we're the same hearts that were living 2000 years ago. We're the same heart conditions of the people around us right now. And at the core of our hearts, we were made by a creator who knit into us the desire to worship him, to know him, to draw near to him, who knit into us the very things that make us human. And I think we have to move past the nervousness at times if people don't want to hear this, and know that people need to hear this, that the spirits within them will resonate with truth because they were knit together too. You know, that the truth of God will always pierce hearts, whether you plant a seed and it's 30 years later that the person cares to pay much mind to it. The truth always has the power to set us free. And the truth is for the Holy Spirit to open people's eyes to transform hearts. We're just asked to be the messengers, the middlemen, the ones who are vulnerable enough to start the conversations, to get uncomfortable, to speak the truth, and trust that God will do what he intends to with it. So I'm so in your camp. I'm so like in your boat of getting it. I literally wrote this book thinking there's no one that's a millennial want to read it, because we just don't care.
Yeah.
But the more I've shared about it, the more, I mean, you would be amazed at the number of messages and notes that have come in, and emails and texts and calls of like, oh my gosh, thank you for talking about this stuff because I didn't know we could, or someone tried to a while back and it just didn't land and I wish it would have. You know, we just never know. We never know where the seeds are going to scatter and land. We're just asked to scatter them. We're just asked to be the farmer and to plant the seeds. And so if someone had come to me, I think, you know, when I was in the height of my sexual deviance, I think it would have been their assumption that I wouldn't have received it. But I think people would have been shocked of how deeply it would have resonated with me, how desperate and thirsty I was for a message of hope when I was in that very place. You know, it's amazing because it's one thing to read scripture of like the woman at the well or the adulteress that was to be stoned and, you know, to read it and glean wisdom from it and understand the greater message. It's another to read it when you are the woman, when you are the adulteress to be stoned. It speaks to you very differently and very powerfully. And so I don't think we can ever count that adulteress out. You know, I don't think we can ever count the millennial who seems not to care out of needing the very same truths. And honestly, I think this book, truly, Sex, Jesus, and the Conversations the Church Forgot, the title alone has the power to kind of break through these stiff walls that people feel around the sex talk from a church person, like to hand them this and say, hey, we've actually missed the mark in talking about this. We're shifting here. We want to shift the culture here. And we want to talk about, you know, these deeper things. You're seen, you're known, you're loved, you're valued, you carry worth. There is so much more for you. And here's a resource, you know, maybe you'll read it. I think as we begin to just kind of take the leaps of faith and start the conversation in a different way and build relationships, no matter whether it looks like the girl is the woman at the well who doesn't want to hear it, I think we have to be the ones to just not assume and to take a leap and to see where it lands, and to plant seeds, because there'll be a harvest if we don't give up. But we just got to scatter them, you know?
And the truth is the world, whether they know it or not, they're starving for truth. And so, and I do love what you said about, we can plant a seed, you know, if, as the Holy Spirit leads us to talk to somebody, we can plant a seed, and that doesn't mean they're going to turn around tomorrow and, you know, thank us and their life will be changed. And it could be 30 years from now, but you know, it was our job as the Spirit led us to plant the seed, and the Holy Spirit's job to continue to grow that seed. So yeah, thank you for that word and encouragement to, you know, to people who aren't, you know, maybe they're just on the other side as you are now. Just to know how we can help, come alongside others to help bring them to healing too.
Yeah. So good.
Well, I would like to ask you, this question, Mo, how is, your testimony and what you've written in this book, how is that going to change the way you talk about sex with your kids when the time comes?
Oh, that's such a great question. I love that. because to be honest, I have a 4-month-old and a 2-year-old.
Yeah.
The 4-month-old only knows how to chew on her hands. It's pivoting happening there. But already with the 2-year-old, you know, for me, a lot of my problems stemmed out of the fact, and this is not to toss my mom or my dad under the bus. This is just to kind of truthfully say a lot of my problems stemmed out of the fact is that we were like in this culture of people saying like, oh, we've got to have the talk. Mm-hmm. Like it's a one singular time conversation. Like, you know, we just kind of broach sexuality, sex, all the things that fall under this umbrella, like a single time. And then it's awkward between the teenager and the parent and blah, blah, blah. For me, that's disastrous. Mm-hmm. Because if it's a one single time talk, it is awkward. It is weird. If your child has never heard you talk about these things before, then when they're 13 and they're awkward, the talk becomes awkward.
Right.
For me, with my 2-year-old already, we are already talking to her about the beauty of her body, the beauty of God's design. We are affectionate as a husband and a wife in front of her. We are already trying to very intentionally model the beauty of what it means to be husband and wife. I talk to her all the time, just little ways. It's simple stuff. It's nothing crazy. I'm not breaking down the theology of like her worth in the Creator's eyes.
Right.
I'm just simply, you know, well, already at 2 years old, talk to her about, gosh, look how beautifully you are made. God designed you like so incredibly, and you are precious. You are wonderful. You know, just instilling her worth in her now. And talking about the differences between mommy and daddy, you know, and, mm-hmm. and our bodies, because yes, we have a clear glass shower and the child runs in and is mesmerized. Like no avoiding, you know, right. The exposure of certain things already, but, celebrating it, talking about the beauty of it, not making sex this weird, taboo, shameful thing, but, you know, already sort of celebrating God's design in who we are. And that will, I know then lead to deeper conversations, to questions that she will ask. But I, you know, I'm sure there's moms of like 15 years old who are rolling their eyes, like, listen to this mom of a 2-year-old talk who hasn't like been in the season we're in. And I'm not discounting that. I'm sort of, I guess, theoretical here in what I hope things will, you know, play out like, but I just hope that as a mother, I can always and will always facilitate relationship with my children to where when important or hard questions come, there's no shame or guilt to come to me and talk about it. There's no awkwardness in, you know, me speaking about certain things, that sex isn't taboo, but that sex is understood as a gift from God, as an act of worship from a young age. You know, I mean, it will never be a one-time talk in our family. It will be an ongoing lifetime conversation because it's important and it's meant to be. Now here's the funny kicker. I like try to talk to my daughter and Bill. This is just a one example. I try to build her up, and I'm always thinking, you know, in the back of my mind, you know, how I can just so intentionally like guide these convos.
Yeah.
And the other day I was in the bathroom getting dressed and getting ready, and I finished my hair, and I was like, oh, doesn't mommy look so beautiful? And she goes, mm-hmm, but not nakey. And I'm, oh, come on. I just had a baby. I'm over here thinking, how can I build up her worth and value? And she's over here tearing mine down unintentionally. But no, it's just, I think, you know, already celebrating these things, talking about this stuff, it will become less awkward, and we can kind of move out of the model of like the 1950s yeah. father sitting down with their son. The truth of the matter is that our kids are coming across this stuff at 7, 8, 9 years old,
yeah.
you know, and we've got to beat the culture to the punch on shaping their views and their perspective about it all. And so we've got to humanize it. We've got to celebrate it. And we've got to talk about it. And I really think that Sex, Jesus, and the Conversations the Church Forgot is a great tool for parents to read, even of littles, to understand really the heart stuff behind it and to prepare themselves to have the conversations, you know, to start the conversation now.
Yeah.
And,
yeah.
you know, understand nowadays. And I say this now, Lord, the culture's even changing right before our eyes when it comes to social media stuff. That's even different from when I was, you know, in college. Mm-hmm. But to understand what their daughters, what their sons are navigating through, and to be able to kind of start to broach those things in really important ways.
Yeah, I agree that it needs to be an ongoing conversation. And something that I, you know, because I've always been just so terrified of like the talk, and just through, you know, conversation with you and just podcasts I've listened to and books and just testimonies of other mothers who've already been there, is that, you know, it's not this awkward one-time thing, but you do want to keep that door open, if you will. And if you answer their questions now, like, so my son, or like when I was pregnant with one of his siblings, he asked me where babies came from. And I told him, and I think he was 3.5. And at 3.5, he was just like, oh, okay. You know?
Yeah.
And so sometimes if you tell the kid, you know, a 7-year-old isn't going to think about sex the way a 16-year-old is. Like, it's just, right. you're just not, they're just not developmentally yeah. there. And so to give them this, it's really just kind of facts at that point. And it makes it a little bit easier. And then they yeah. already have that foundation. And then, you know, you can kind of bring in the stuff as it gets more complicated.
Yeah.
You know, exactly. with their hormones and everything are involved. So I appreciate that perspective too. And I just... I don't know. It still makes me nervous, but you know, I'm just trying.
Oh,
I'm trying my. I know.
I feel like I'm especially terrified. I know I've talked to other women who are like, I have sons. That's terrifying.
Yeah,
but
I
my
know.
Only perspective is daughters, and I'm like, no, that's terrifying.
Right.
I just feel like where our culture is at right now, across the board for parents, it is scary.
Yeah.
You know, because it is so hard to. Yeah. to guard and shield. And we just can't guard and shield from every single thing. They're going to come across stuff. They're going to be exposed to stuff. Lord, you can't even turn on the TV and watch a hamburger commercial without it being overly sexualized nowadays. So it's just there. And I think rather than like being scared, and even though I want this to be the case, just like holing up in our house and unplugging everything, that's just not practical.
Yeah.
We are called to live in the world, but not of it. And so I think we just got to get intentional, you know, and kind of face the fear and beat it to the punch and just be really intentional. I feel like a lot of the, you know, scarring in my life and sexual testimony came because there just wasn't a ton of intentionality around me talking about truth.
Yeah.
It's like the family assumed the church was talking about it. The church assumed the family was talking about it. In the end, nobody was really talking about it.
Right.
And the world was shaping everything I thought about it all. And so I don't think it's like malice a lot of the times by parents or by the church. I think it's just, we've made it awkward and it's not ever meant to be. And so we just got to get intentional and get uncomfortable and, you know, find comfort in it so that it becomes something that's on the table to discuss.
Mm-hmm. Agreed. All right, Mo, these are my last two questions that I ask all the guests who come on the podcast. So
Yay!
The first one is, as you are standing where you are, you know, looking back, what God, you know, did in your life and sort of where you are now, looking forward to what he has for you in the future, what's a heart lesson that you feel him impressing upon your heart lately?
Oh, I love that. So you're going to get me all fired up. I'll preach for another hour. He has just really, really been revealing to me in some really incredible ways the power of the Holy Spirit's operation through us as mm-hmm. followers of Christ. The gospel does not just come to us in our brokenness, restore us, and stop with us. The gospel moves through us and always should. And the Holy Spirit has immeasurable things in store for us to do through us. And we have got to we've got to let down our guard and open up our hands and say, send me, Lord. What mm-hmm. would you have of me? What would you speak to me? Jeremiah 33:3 says, ask me and I will tell you remarkable things you do not know of what's to come. And lately I've just been on my face asking him, tell me, Lord, I'm here. Talk to me, you know, make yourself evident and alive to me. And he does every single time. And he really has just been opening my eyes to the fact that he equips us with power by the Holy Spirit, to heal, to speak truth, to speak life, to be courageous, to speak words of knowledge, wisdom, prophetic truths, to yield to the Spirit, to really lean into it and to watch all that he invites us into in participation of kingdom work. And it's like really cool. You know, it's just really, really cool when you commune with him and you realize, man, this is like a teamwork thing. This is incredible. He is the general and we are an army of believers behind him. And he has so much in store for us. And so just moving in the power of the Spirit and learning and leaning into more of what that looks like has been really, really awesome.
Mm-hmm. I love that. And I feel like at times in my life when that's happening, it's almost like you are having an out-of-body experience. I mean, in a way of like, you're like watching your life as the Lord is moving through. You're like, wow, I can't believe God's leading me in that way. Like, I can't believe that just happened and that prayer was just answered. It's pretty incredible. I would agree with you. Okay. My last question, just a fun way to end the podcast. What is something you are looking forward to?
Losing baby weight. I don't know why that's the first thing that comes to my mind. I am so looking forward to, just everything God has in store. He has just been so alive these past few months in our lives. And especially with the launch of this book, I just can't wait to hear from people. I can't wait to see what he does with this vulnerability because he's so faithful to do immeasurably more than we could imagine when we open up our hands and are vulnerable, just like we were just talking about. And so, I'm excited what he does with this book. I'm excited to be done with the book launch process so that I can, have an hour in the day to go to the gym and get some of this body back. I'm excited for this resource to be out there and as God begins to sort of be the pulse and the heartbeat of it. Cause for an author, when you're writing, when you're building, you know, the plan with your publishing team, when you're releasing it, it's just a lot of head down, grinded out labor. But it's so amazing when a book finally releases, it begins to really just take on a life of its own and you get to just sit back and see what God does. And so I'm excited for that. And I'm excited for the time it may open up in my schedule to go for a jog, to out, breathe some fresh air.
Yeah. Oh, I hear you on that. Well, this conversation has been amazing. I am so thankful I got the opportunity to talk with you. Tell us where we can find you all over the interweb.
Yes, everywhere on the interwebs. I have a website, moisom.com, that has just about everything. I mean, from blog post writing to I travel the country speaking. If, you know, an organization is interested in that, super easy. They can reach out there. It's just a great site and resource. And they can find all of my social media connections on there too. I'm also super in love with the Instagrams. That's probably the most active social media element that I'm on. So that's just at Mo Isom, and love to engage with people on there. Also on Facebook and on Twitter. But Instagram personally to me is really where it's
because we need to see those babies is really why we need to go to Instagram.
I didn't grow humans for nothing. You're going to see.
Know. Yeah, that's great. Well, Mo, this has been such a great conversation. Thank you for taking time out of your day to chat with me and, praying all God's best for you as you launch this book into the world and, excited to see where it takes you and where it takes, the conversation about sex. So thank you.
Yeah, of course. My pleasure.
Mo said that we cannot forget that the purity that God calls his children to is a heart purity. And no matter what you're facing today, whether it's sexual temptation or not, that is something we can all take to heart, that we all need to have pure hearts before the Father, not just about our actions on the outside, but it's about the purity of our hearts on the inside. I just want to take a minute right now to talk to anyone right now who felt particularly like Mo was talking right to them. If you find yourself deep in sexual sin of any kind, I just want to encourage you right now to pursue freedom from that bondage. I just want you to know, as Mo's testimony illustrated so beautifully, that you are not beyond saving. And Jesus's power can reach even those of you who might feel incredibly dirty and unworthy from the things that you have built habits with. Don't feel like you are past being forgiven and past being loved by the Father who sent his Son for you. And I know it might be a really uncomfortable journey, and it might be incredibly difficult to take that first step. But today, I just want to encourage you to do that. And just to reiterate what Mo said, it might be 5 minutes of awkward conversation, but it's for your soul. It's for eternity. And it's important, as she said, to just get uncomfortable for the sake of your own life. So if that's you today, just push through the awkwardness. Think of somebody right now who you can text or call and just cry out for help. And just be brave enough to take that 5 minute conversation, because there is so much life on the other side of it. And if you find yourself in that place of wanting to get help right now, I know there is a group. It's called Celebrate Recovery. It meets at many churches across the country and maybe even internationally. I'm actually not sure, but I'll put a link in the show notes, and you can see if there's a Celebrate Recovery group that meets at a church near you. And it is basically a support group for people struggling with all sorts of addiction. And I think it could be a really incredible healing tool for anyone who is listening right now that wants to break free of the sexual bondage that they are in, but doesn't quite know how. And that could be a great resource for you. I just wanted to take a minute to go ahead and just pray over everyone listening. I know this could be a sensitive topic, and I know there are so many people here listening who this might be your story. You know, your story might be so much like Mo's story, and you might be seeking to get out of it, and you don't know how. And so I want to pray for you, and I also want to pray for the person who you will be reaching out to. I want to pray for those people as well. Dear Father, I just want to lift up every woman listening to this episode who is struggling in any way with what Mo struggled with and what her testimony is all about, Father. I pray that these women would know that you are capable of redeeming anything, and no one is too far gone to be saved by you. I pray that they would know your love and your redeeming power. And in the words of Natalie Grant's song, Clean, there's nothing too dirty that you can't make worthy. And Father God, I pray for the people who those women are going to reach out to, the ones that they're going to cry out for help to help guide them along this way. I pray that they will be brave. I pray that they will be kind and compassionate and empathetic and understanding. I pray that they will demonstrate your love in the truest, most sincere way to these women who are hurting. I pray that you will empower them to empower the women who come to them for help. And I just pray and thank you for what Mo's testimony and what this book is going to do for a hurting world, Father. Just bless it and use it and multiply it. In your name, amen. Well, friends, thank you so much for listening, and such a huge thank you to Mo for her book and for her message and her testimony. Don't forget to check out moisom.com to find out more about her and her message and all the things that she is doing. She's such a strong voice when it comes to, talking about sexual sin and how to break free from it. And so I'm just so grateful for her voice in this world. Don't forget that you can find show notes for this episode at sararicke.com/podcast. And there were so many great things that Mo mentioned. So on the show notes page, you're going to find a list of scriptures that she mentioned, all the helpful resources that she mentioned, some of the great takeaway truths that she shared with us. And then I just added some other helpful resources that I thought might be great to include, with regards to the subject matter in this episode. So a few things I wanted to mention. Podcaster and author Jamie Ivey just released a book entitled If You Only Knew. And there are chapters in there where she talks about her sexual testimony and how she had to overcome the shame that came along with her past. And so that might be a great book for you to check out if you're looking for another story similar to Mo's story. You might also want to listen to episode 32 of the Heart Lessons podcast, where Shelley Hitz talks about her addiction to pornography and how she overcame that. And then I also wanted to mention that I think you should take a listen to the song Clean by Natalie Grant, especially if you are struggling with feeling very unworthy and dirty from this type of sin. It's such a powerful song. And so all of the links are going to be in the show notes for you to be able to just click on and take you right to all these helpful resources. I have also added something new, a journal and reflection page that's going to go along with every episode of the Heart Lessons podcast. So you can download that, print it out at home, and kind of reflect on the truths that were shared in each and every episode. I know that all of us, no matter where you're coming from today, were able to take away some really incredible things from this episode. Feel free to find me over on Instagram, Sarah_Rieke, R-I-E-K-E. And we can talk, about this episode or any of the other heart lessons that you have listened to. I would love to connect with you over there or via email, sarahjrieke@gmail.com. Thank you so much, friends, for listening. And as always, my prayer as you listen through these episodes, that you'll take a look at your own heart and your own life and be able to come away with a heart lesson of your own to help you draw closer to the Lord. Bye, guys.
I see a shattered, you see whole. I see a broken, but you see beautiful. And you're helping me to believe. Sacrifice, your blood flowed red and made me